Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for coming out on what must be the loveliest day of this summer. Very much appreciated. My name is Nick Cranfley. I'm the Vice Principal here at Morley College. And it falls to me to introduce Rob Cowan, who, as you always say, needs no introduction, but I'm afraid he's going to get one. Before that, I'd just like to tell you a little bit about the event. Tonight is the last of a series of penny lectures that we've held during the course of this year. And they're called penny lectures because they go back to the very foundation of Morley College, which some of you may know, but those of you who don't are going to hear about it over the next 2 minutes. And that is that Morley College started out as sort of the educational project of the Old Vic Theatre. The Old Vic Theatre was trying to put Waterloo straight. It was a very disreputable area, unlike today, of course. The founder of the Old Vic Theatre, as it now is, Emma Cons, was a social pioneer, housing pioneer, and she tried to turn the Old Vic round from a rather dodgy music hall into a place of improving entertainment. And one of those entertainments was a series of lectures. Those lecture series were extremely popular. They attracted 800, 900 people. There's no television. This is in the 1880s. They grew into lecture series, and the lecture series grew into classes, and eventually there was enough of a call, demand, to turn those classes into a college, and lo and behold, we had Morley College. They're called penny lectures because you could get in for a penny, and we've retained that today, so you've been able to get in for a penny. However, you weren't necessarily able to get out for a penny. In these straitened times, we are keen on fundraising. We have a bursary fund to help those who are more disadvantaged be able to come and take courses at the college. So if you enjoy this evening, please do contribute to our bursary fund as you go out. One last thing is also, this has been a special year. It's been our 125th anniversary. This has just drawn us to the end of the year. This is the last event of our 125th anniversary celebrations. We've published a book, which is over there, which if you are interested in Morley College and its history, which is absolutely fascinating, then please do buy one. They cost 25 quid, but for this audience tonight, I can do it for 20. So do have a look afterwards and flick through one, and if you'd like to buy one, well then we'd love to sell it to you. So at this point, I would normally say, without any further ado, I'm going to hand over to Rob. However, there is one more ado, and that is this lecture series, which has been a fascinating, broad-ranging series. We've literally, from the garden, the gorilla garden in the traffic island in the road over there, to the stars and the universe and everything in between, has been organised fantastically by Hannah over there. And I've got to publicly say, well done, Hannah, thank you so much, because she's going to unfortunately leave us. So I think it needed a public acknowledgement for all the hard work and fantastic way she's run it. So Hannah, thank you very much. Without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Rob now, who you know is a feature of Radio 3. He's one of those broadcasters that you think you know because his voice is so familiar, his manner is so wonderful, and he does that Reithian thing, doesn't he, of informing you, entertaining you and educating you. And I hope he's going to do that tonight. So Rob, it's a pleasure to have you coming for Educate and Entertain Us.
Well, it's extremely good to see so many people here braving the weather. Absolutely diabolical conditions out there. I've come all the way from Bushy in Hertfordshire, and I made the mistake of coming to Waterloo and walking from Waterloo. So by the time I got here, I was drenched through, but they've got a nice canteen, so I had a nice cup of tea, so there you are, and did some reading. But it's a great pleasure to be here. The subject I've chosen is war and music, and the reason that I've chosen it, apart from the fact that there are countless extremely interesting recordings that you can hear, is the relationship between music and musicians and various totalitarian regimes is extremely complicated. And maybe it's worth dwelling on one or two artists whose reputations were tarnished by their associations with the Soviets or the Nazis or whatever. And on one or two occasions, you can learn a little bit, at least I learned a little bit, about artists who are now largely forgotten, but who were greatly respected by composers like Mahler, for example, whose music we hear a lot of today, and whose music we won't really understand unless you've heard people like Bruno Walter in his prime in the 1930s, or Willem Mengelberg in the 1930s also, who knew Mahler well, and therefore had a sort of hotline to his muse in a way that a lot of modern interpreters don't have. And the reason I say that, I've got a bit of a bee in my bonnet about a lot of modern Mahler interpretation, that it's too soft, it's too luxuriant. And if you go back in time and hear some of these earlier recordings, you hear there's real grit to the way the music is played. It's dangerous, that's what I'm trying to say. But first of all, I want to play you a great German baritone, recorded during the Reich period in 1937 in a little aria from Rodelinda by Handel. It's the King of Lombardy who sings, "The noises of brooks and streams in the dark weep with me, and the mountains and the grottos make plaintive sounds, lamenting as I lament." It's only a short aria, and just as an example of Gerhard Hüsch's beautiful baritone, this is a live recording which is very little known, a radio recording. I'd like to start by just playing this first track.
Thank you.
Bush, one of those artists who had the ability to tease the music, the musical line, just beyond the bar line, or keep it before the bar line, totally free in the way he interpreted that music. A wonderful example of German radio engineering from 1938. Now, Hüsch went on to record famous Lieder cycles, or had already recorded them actually for EMI. But in 1934, and I'm not going to play you much of this, only a snatch of it on the second track, he recorded this. Wache, the Sturmlied, or the Storm Song, or a Assault Song, which was eventually supplanted by the Horst Wessel Song, and that was in 1934. Now that begs the question, I don't think that Hüsch ever recorded anything remotely like that again, what would he have thought later in his career, given what happened in Germany between, say, 1936 and the end of the war, would he have reproached himself for making that record a blatantly patriotic Nazi song, which is what it was? One doesn't know. Certainly, some of the other great musicians like Furtwängler and Wilhelm Backhaus, and I could name Georg Kuhlenkamp, loads of them. We'll be having examples of them later on. So that's quite a humbling example of a bit of a faux pas by a great artist. Now, on the other side, I found an extremely rare recording by the Jewish Culture League. This was the originally called the Kulturbund Deutscher Juden. This was the Cultural Federation of German Jews in 1933, and they were allowed to form their own orchestra. The name Deutsche was eradicated because the Germans didn't want them associated with them, only to have their own orchestra and play themselves. Now, they made a few records, and of course they were top grade musicians in Germany at the time who hadn't got out in time or decided not to leave Germany because they felt that it would all blow over. There were people. Bruno Walter was one of them, who as late as 1938, as we'll hear, couldn't believe what was happening and thought that, you know, at the last minute there would be a reprieve and everything would go back to normal, which, as we know, of course, was very far from the truth. But I've brought along just one movement from the Serenata Notturna by Mozart. And if you think the conditions under which this recording was made, and you heard it, it would just sound another 78 of a first-rate band of players playing Mozart in the 1930s. Of course, that's not quite what it is.
Thank you.
Now, I know that's slightly old-fashioned in the way the strings play there with portamenti or slides, and it's quite sweet in comparison with the way Mozart is played nowadays, but there's elegance there and real musicianship. And it reminds us of how the chamber music scene in particular was wrecked in those days, because, say, the Bush String Quartet, a wonderful quartet, none of whose members were Jewish, by the way, left as soon as the Nazis came to power and were never to play there. I think they did go there briefly after the war, about 1951. And of course, the various musicians from the German orchestras who were thrown into exile and sometimes killed. Mahler's concertmaster famously came to London, and his daughter was the leader of the camp orchestra in Auschwitz. The interesting thing about her, Alma Rose, her name was, is she was actually given a proper ceremonial burial by the Nazis in Auschwitz. They so respected her. I know that doesn't count for very much, but under the circumstances, but it is quite a significant fact. Now, I'd like to go to Amsterdam. I've mentioned Willem Mengelberg, who was the great conductor who led the orchestra for 50 years. He's a great friend of Mahler. In fact, he instigated a Mahler festival in 1920, where all Mahler symphonies were played. There was one occasion where Mengelberg conducted the Fourth Symphony in the first half of a concert, and Mahler conducted the Fourth Symphony in the second half of the concert. And they were great friends and greatly admired each other. But there's one very disturbing document of Mahler's Das Lied von der Erde that was recorded at the Concertgebouw in 1939. Another marvelous conductor, Karl Schüricht, who was a German conductor, was doing the honours. And in the last movement, in the most funereal part of the music, which goes down into the depths, at that darkest point, that darkest chord, utter stillness, a woman stands up and shouts, "Deutschland über alles, Herr Schüricht." And that was recorded. And I can't resist playing it to you. Well, the sound is very good, but there's a lot of hissing goes on as soon as she says that, as if, shut up, you know, sit down. And it's a wonderful performance, because Mengelberg, because I've seen some of his scores in New York, littered his scores with indications as to how the music should be played. And that Das Lied must have been an example. So listening to Schüricht conduct it must have been a little bit like listening to Mengelberg conduct it, which he did at the Concertgebouw. Now, I'd like to, while we're on the subject of Mahler, we'll have a little Mahler fest for a few minutes. I'd like to talk a little bit about the way Mahler was conducted before the war, a little digression. The New York Philharmonic issued, not long ago, well, it was a few years ago now, a series of interviews with musicians who played under Mahler at the New York Philharmonic. And they just, it's wonderful. It was originally issued on the fourth side of two LPs of Mahler's Ninth with Leonard Bernstein. And I have to confess, I listened to that fourth side of those interviews much more than I did Bernstein's recording of the Ninth Symphony. The voices are absolutely priceless. They were marvelous to listen to. And the impressions and the pathos of these people who actually adored Mahler, and, you know, Toscanini, the speed demon, wonderful conductor again, came after us, but they thought Mahler was an infinitely greater musician. Anyway, I want to play you just a few, about 30 seconds, or maybe a little bit more, of a musician in the Philharmonic describing how Mahler started the Fourth Symphony in his interpretation. And what he's going to say, and then I will play you a little bit of Mengelberg, a precious recording, the only recording we have of Mengelberg conducting a complete Mahler symphony, which fortunately is the same symphony, the Fourth Symphony, and you'll be able to hear the parallels between Mahler's conducting, as sung by this old gentleman, and Mengelberg's conducting as practiced in this particular performance with the Concertgebouw Orchestra, which makes his Mahler 4 to me the most authentic Mahler 4 we have. But first of all, let's hear William Malloch interview this old gentleman.
His fourth symphony, his theme is da 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 ti. My God, he has all the first violins.
Right, that's the guy from the New York Philharmonic. Now, if I play you the opening on Mengelberg, it's not so apparent when the theme first comes in with that slide, that portamento from under the note, but the second time it comes in, you can hear la-dee-dum-wee-dum-dum. You can hear that happening. And there is no other recording on earth that plays it like that. So I think we can take it that we're listening to something that's very much like Mahler himself. Anyway, let's hear the first sort of minute and a half or so of the Mengelberg. Some people do try and copy the old portamento, and it just sounds so contrived that you've got to play it with the right sort of feeling. Playing stringed instruments with slides, which approximates the way people sing, is fine if what you're actually doing is singing with the instrument, but not if you're just copying the mannerisms of an earlier generation, and that's another argument. Now I'm going to stick my last Mahler Bruno Walter from 1938. This is the 16th of January, 1938. And in Austria, this was the last performance of a Mahler symphony before the Anschluss. And it is charged with the most unbelievable intensity. In fact, I heard on the old third program when I was a kid, I heard somebody talking about it, and I went to our local library and I got out the recording of Mahler's Ninth Symphony with Bruno Walter, and which sounded in those days, I have to say, I mean, I'm not that ancient, but I'm not young. It sounded like modern music, you know. It took me a long time, but I started to get into it, and I really was starting to love the music. And I got to know this Columbia Symphony that Walter recorded about 1961. And I got to know it pretty well, and I loved it. But then I heard this version from 1938, and it was like a shot in the arm. I couldn't believe that this was the same conductor, because it was a different world. Well, of course, it was a different world, and a far less happy one. But the fact is that Mahler's symphonies, the Ninth in particular, was prophetic of horrors to come in many respects. So in a way, what Walter was doing was bringing out the rage in the music in a way that nobody else managed to do. And I'd like, first of all, for you to hear, before I play you the other thing that was happening in another part of the world on the same night, exactly the same night, I want to play you just a little bit of this, the first movement of this Mahler night. If you felt the intensity of that performance, the bite of the strings, the way the whole orchestra seemed to erupt under Walter's direction. And Walter had given the premiere of that work, I think it was in 1911, so he was very closely associated with it. And here he was, conducting the orchestra in a city where Mahler was so famous, and where Mahler was on the brink of being banned as a composer and would remain banned for the next goodness knows how many years. Tragic. Now, the night that performance was taking place, don't forget we're talking about the 16th of January 1938, over in America at Carnegie Hall, and this is another live recording. That was a live recording of the actual event, and so is this. Thank you. had on the same night was the last Mahler in Vienna and the first jazz at Carnegie Hall. That was the first jazz concert ever at Carnegie Hall with Benny Goodman and Gene Krupa and Teddy Wilson. Fabulous, fabulous, fabulous concert, which you can get on CD, I'm happy to tell you, and sounds marvellous even. And the thing is that both those recordings sound fantastic for their years. Now this next recording, I'm going to play you about 5 minutes of this because it's such a moving event. In fact, when I put it on my Sunday programme, I had people emailing into the programme saying that they had to pull in to a lay-by, they were driving because they were in tears. And somebody sent me this recording over from the Czech Philharmonic, and I managed to persuade Supraphon, which is the national Czech record company, to issue it commercially. It's the Czech conductor Václav Tulik, who, like Mengelberg in Holland, was the great maestro with the Czech Philharmonic in the 1920s and 1930s, well, actually beyond that as well, conducting the great patriotic symphonic cycle Maflust by Smetana, My Fatherland, which was one of the first orchestral works as a kid I got to know, and it thrilled my, the particular movement I got to hear was called Sharka, about an Amazon, which to me was like thrilling film music. I heard it when I was about 12, and I had to get a record of 78 of it, I think it was in those days. But this is something different. Tarlik recorded, there are four recordings of the complete Maflust, which plays for about 70 or 80 minutes, with Tarlik conducting. All with the Czech Philharmonic, the first one from the late 20s, then there's one from the wartime, and then there's one from the 50s. This one is 1939. The wartime one's 1942. I'm beginning to sound like a nerd, total anorak here, but there's a reason for this. This one was recorded not long after the Germans entered Prague. And I'm not talking about the Sudetenland, I'm talking actually occupying Prague. And it's astonishing. If you hear the reaction to the crowd at the end of each piece, it's like you're at Loftus Road. It's not like you're at the Rudolf Ilgen or the Prague Theatre or wherever it's recorded, or a Wembley football crowd or something like that. But come the end of the cycle, which is a piece called Blahnik, the crowd again erupts, but something incredible happens. It begins to die down, and then everybody breaks into the Czech national anthem. And for me, it's one of the most moving documents that we have of that period in terms of music and the way it's performed. Not only because of the intensity of performance, because Tarlik was giving everything that he had to this performance, but the way the audience was reacting to him, to the music, and to the situation. And you can hear, in addition to appreciation, hope. So let's hear that. Thank you. incredibly moving. Here we are, Mavlast, recorded in June 1939 at the Prague National Theatre with Tully and the Czech Philharmonic. Now, I've got too much to play, so I'm going to have to cut some things out, I'm sorry to say, but there are a couple of things, well, some more things. Track 12 next. This is very interesting because there are other recordings where the evidence of war is audible on the recordings themselves. One of them, much loved by me, and I'm sure by hundreds of thousands of people, is the harpsichord player Wanda Landowska, who was the most amazing character. She had her harpsichord taken on a stretch to play for Tolstoy, which she did. She lived like a very old-fashioned, somebody from a previous century, apparently. There was a television interview with her once, which I will never forget, where she was talking about her life, and suddenly, she was sitting on a harpsichord, and suddenly she turned around and played the Italian concerto by Bach. She was absolutely fabulous. A wonderful musician, flamboyant. He played this instrument which sounded, well, I mean, it wasn't exactly the sort of harpsichords that get played today. It was a sort of mega sort of amplifier. Well, it wasn't amplified, but it was a huge instrument which made a very grand sound, almost like a Steinway piano. She played it brilliantly. And she studied with Leschetizky, who was one of the great teachers of the day, also taught Schnabel and Ignaz Friedman and various others. Now, I'm going to play you a B minor sonata by Scarlatti that was recorded in Paris. And there was anti-aircraft fire going on in the background. You know it. You know this, don't you? And she just refused to come out of the studio. She was going to finish her Scarlatti sonata, and you could do what you liked. And it's a wonderful piece of playing as well, so let's hear it. This is track 12. So that's Landowska in Paris in 1940. Now, I have another very interesting document, this one from Germany in 1944. And it gives you a fair indication of how far the Germans have got in terms of their technique, in terms of their recording techniques, because this is a genuine stereo recording of Walter Gieseking playing the Emperor Concerto, and you can hear the bombs going off. I'll only play you a short passage from the cadenza of the first movement of the Emperor Concerto. This is what's happening on the other side. Symphony Beethoven. Now there are lots of recordings of Furtwängler conducting the choral, at least three or four of them done during the war. It was a fabulous, if idiosyncratic conception of the piece, extremely free. Furtwängler was a student of Heinrich Schenker, which meant that harmonic architecture was everything. And he didn't always go with a book, certainly not by metronome markings or anything like that. He played very free, but you entered a Furtwängler performance and it was like a mystical experience. This particular performance is said to have taken place in front of Hitler and other dignitaries from the Nazi party. And it comes to the end, there's a prestissimo, as I'm sure you've heard, the end of the choral symphony. And normally with Furtwängler, what you hear is this great, you know, it comes to the end, and love it, da 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 da, and gets to the end of it, and there's great volleys of applause and all that. You get to the end of this, and there's dead silence for a few seconds, and then they start tentatively clapping. Now, I know I'm going to sound like an old cynic here, but I'm not totally convinced that this isn't a fake. It may be true, because, to be perfectly honest, it's very much like the other endings of the choral symphony with Furtwängler. But I'll play it for you all the same. It's track 14. Myself about that. It seems far too pointed a gesture, but you know, maybe I'm wrong. I could be completely wrong on that. Anyway, I want to go to track 16 now. This is a fascinating story. This is the Russian pianist Maria Yudina, who turns up in Sviatoslav Richter's notebooks because he couldn't stand the fact that her breath smelled and she had bad teeth or something like that. She was an incredibly brave woman. And she promoted modern music. People like Stravinsky and Prokofiev and other people would play in Soviet Russia during these Sadanov years, during the accusations of formalism and all the things that were going on. And but Stalin loved her piano playing. And I don't know if any of you know this story. One night he was listening to the radio and he heard her playing 23rd Concerto of Mozart. Absolutely loved it, wanted the record, as many of us would. Phoned up, you know, whoever it was at Moscow Radio, can I have the record? Oh gosh, what am I going to do? There isn't a record. So what do? They go out in the middle of the night and they make a record. And that is what happened. And the record does survive. Of Yudina and Alexander Galk, who was one of the conductors around at the time, doing this 23rd piano concerto of Mozart. Sometimes people say to me, there's any musician in the world you've not interviewed, interviewed some, who you'd love to interview. If you could bring them back to life, she would certainly be one I'd love to interview. Because everything I read about her, her courage, her personality, her musical taste, her interpretations are remarkable. I mean, she's like a Landowska of the piano. Landowska played the piano as well. So bold, so outreaching in her interpretations, not exactly the most elegant Mozartian. If you were playing for Stalin, you wouldn't be either. But anyway, I've got this recording here for you, so we'll just hear a little, some of it on track 16. Thank you. Keystone Cops style. But there's a very remarkably free account of that, the 23rd. We've got some lovely playing as well. It's interesting, she was awarded the Stalin Prize, Yudina, and she donated its monetary portion to the Orthodox Church, and here I quote, for perpetual prayers for Stalin's sins. So there's somebody you can chalk up to investigate on Wiki, I think. It'd be brilliant, absolutely. Now, I have the Leningrad Symphony of Shostakovich to do next. I think we'll skip that because it's so well known. I'd like to play you a bit of something else instead. This is Prokofiev's cantata for the 20th anniversary of the October Revolution. A remarkable piece that he started working on in the 1930s, which would have been the 20th anniversary. And he decided, because of the political climate at the time, that it wasn't terribly safe to perform it, so it got shelved, and the first recording of it came out in the 1960s. Well, it's very interesting. My next guest on Essential Classics is the TV presenter and journalist Jeremy Vine. And because, you know, he's interested in politics and music and all that, what I normally do at the end of each week is I choose a piece for the guest. And I chose this for him. And his reaction was most interesting. Because he loved it, he thought it was extremely exciting. He said, you know, it sounds like Prokofiev was taking the rise out of the whole thing. But he wasn't really taking it seriously at all, because you get somebody shouting Lenin's words over a megaphone, you get piano accordion players sounding like Jimmy Shan's band coming in at one stage, you get imitated machine gun fire on the percussion. It is a total riot. It's very exciting, but we must hear it someday. Track 19.
Thank you.
I just think you have to play that to Nigel Farage, I think. I don't agree with Jeremy Vine. I think that that was written in dead earnest, and I still find it incredibly exciting, that piece. Even more exciting than Alexander Nevsky, which is his other big choral piece. Anyway, that was Kirill Kondrashin with Ivan Petrov, who was the reciting the Lenin's words in that. Now, we want some time for questions, don't we? Nick, is that true?
If you're willing to take them, yes.
I'd be more than willing to take, but I'd like to play just one more thing, and that is Richard Tauber, another piece of lovely singing. He was a great friend of Leha, who wrote a lot of his major roles for him. Because he was part Jewish, of course, he was banned from Germany during the war. He was seriously ill with lung cancer, so after the war he came back for the end of his career, he was singing on one lung, but still singing beautifully. And there's a very late broadcast, I think it's the last one he did with Leha conducting himself. And as a sort of reconciliation between all the nations, or the three main nations, or three of the main nations who were at war, he sang, you got a track 23 on there, haven't you? Have you?
Yes, I have.
You have, right, okay. Just that I had included it. He sang You Are My Heart's Delight in three languages in the same performance. In English, in German, and in French. And I find it a very touching tribute and, as I say, an act of reconciliation in a way with a beautiful aria and a great singer, which I think maybe brings this little presentation to a touching close. Let's hear it. 23.
Oh,
We're so grateful that you've given up your time. You don't have to do this. So we're so grateful.
It's been a real pleasure. You've been so lovely and attentive.
Well, they haven't asked the questions yet. Wait.
We're not the friends of Radio 3, are we?
So if you'd like to ask a question, please stick your hand up.
Any questions, anything you want to ask.
If Rob likes the look of you, he'll point at you. And Hannah has a microphone.
Oh, so right, okay. Right. Gentleman at the back.
Thank you. Going back to the Germany of the 1930s, Richard Strauss, the BBC put out a two-album LP set about 40 years ago, the history of the BBC. And on that record, there was a recording of the opening ceremony of the Olympic Games and the Olympic hymn. I've never heard that in its entirety from that day to this. Has the BBC got a copy, and would we be able to hear it on Essential Classics?
Well, that's a good question. They put it out, did they, on the radio or on a record?
On a record.
Which on a record.
Well, on a record.
On an LP.
Yeah, but it was only about 20 seconds. So,
well, I mean, I don't... The answer is I would have to go to the archive and find out. I'm sure that they will have a complete sound document of that whole event, with the music complete.
The music was obviously a live recording.
Yes.
You could hear the crowd in the background.
Well, I mean, look at the things that survived from that. A 1936 Nuremberg rally, the whole of the Act 3, third act of Lohengrin with Furtwängler conducting. That's available complete. You can get that on a CD. So there's tons and tons of stuff from that period. I would imagine that the BBC does have it complete. I can try and find out for you. The problem with putting it on Essential Classics is that, generally speaking, I have a bit of a battle on my hands getting historic recordings on the programme, because, with good reason to some extent, the producers will say, if people turn on and hear something crackly and old, and they haven't heard me introduce it in the way I've been introducing all these pieces tonight, they'll think, what on earth are they playing all these crackly old recordings for? Why can't we hear Evgeny Kissin or Daniel Barenboim or something? Which, you know, is an argument. My argument always is that it isn't whether a recording is old or new, it's whether it's good or bad, whether it's interesting or it isn't interesting. So I defend, in fact, I'm trying to get myself a vintage program on Radio 3 at the moment. I've been to see Alan Davey to talk about it, the new controller, and I think, you know, that I'm banging on about this all the time, because it's the one area in recorded music that simply isn't catered for on any of the stations at the moment.
Unlike music.
And, oh, well, yeah, but I get away with it there. You see, I get my Eric Coates and my Tomlinson and my, you know, Trevor, Ronald Binge and all those people. I can do it, and I get them in. But and I, people don't shout, provided I don't do it too often. But live music, most certainly. Most certainly. Thank you for asking the question.
Rob, I would like to know how you listen, further to the last question. How do you listen to the old stuff? Do you listen to it on 78? Do you listen to it cleaned up? Do you listen with your headphones on digitized versions of 78?
I'll tell you a funny story. My wife and I went with our two young children to holiday to Poole. And I was listening to stuff on headphones with my portable player. And they went into the Paul Pottery Museum. And I said, no, don't worry, I've been in there. I'll just wait there. And I was waiting as I was walking up and down. And the guy who was on the door of the museum said, do you know that strange man who's walking up and down outside with those headphones on? How do I listen? I don't like excessive filtering. I think it ruins the sound. In fact, one particular label transferred Strauss's Also Sprach Zarathustra with Koussevitzky, which was done,
I think, in the 30s. And it did so much filtering on it, it didn't sound like music, it sounded like a fleet of Dakotas coming across the channel. I'm talking about the low O double C, the opening of it. So, do I listen? I think if I'm reviewing them for gramophone, I'll listen on speakers and I'll listen on headphones. Because the great thing about headphone listening is that you hear edits, which you can't hear on speakers. Because a cut or a splice is very obvious when you're listening on headphones. I used to collect 78s, and I had quite a large, average collection of 78s, which is how I got to know. I used to go to the old gramophone exchange in Wardour Street, where you could get 78s of orchestral music for sixpence, if anybody remembers what those were. And that's how I got to know a lot of these great performances. And that's why I got into comparative listening, because I thought, well, hold on, I'll just very, very briefly tell you. I got to know Tchaikovsky's Fifth Symphony through a set of 78s, the Philadelphia Orchestra and Leopold Stokowski, and I loved the work. I played it and played it, I was about 15, I played it and played it and played it and played it. And I saved up my pocket money, and I went out and got an LP on the Concert Classics label for 27 and sixpence. I remember it as clear as day, by the Norddeutsche Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Wilhelm Schuchter. I played it once, and then I went back to my Stokowski 78s, because as worthy as Schuchter was, he was a very good conductor. Stokowski was such a charismatic interpreter. And that was one of those experiences that made me realise that these older musicians had so much. The funny thing was that the Norddeutsche Symphony Orchestra, a broadcast came out later with the Norddeutsche Symphony Orchestra under Stokowski. So you had the sort of combination of the two, and it was like the Philadelphia, it's just like the Philadelphia. So, you know, it's been a constant, I still love hearing, because all these broadcasts, like Actalic, for example, the Mavlas, they're coming out all the time, and you hear, you discover so much. I hope that answers your question. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
If you were to repeat this lecture in 30 years' time, what examples do you think you might give of 21st century music? And incidents?
Well, that's a very, very interesting question. I was just thinking as I was playing this that I could have done the threnody for the victims of Hiroshima by Penderecki, for example, except I had who's the chap Gilbert who wrote all those war books? I can't remember his first name. He wrote to me because he wanted to quote a review that I'd written of that piece in the gramophone in one of his war books. Until he found out that actually Penderecki didn't write it as a threnody for the victims of Hiroshima. He just thought of the title after he'd written the piece, which rather spoils the effect. 21st century music? Probably John Adams. The Death of Klinghoffer works like that. Steve Reich, Different Trains. I'd actually brought Different Trains along tonight. But I thought we haven't really got time to listen to it. I've brought the second movement, which is about the war, which I think, Different Trains, I think is an absolute masterpiece. So I'm sure certainly those two would come along. And I'm trying to think. Bernd Alois Zimmermann, I bring something by him, I'm sure. Incredible composer. So I think there wouldn't be any lack. But I'd still be harking back to these other composers as well, because I think Schoenberg, for example, you know, some Schoenberg I can't stand, but there are works that I think are deeply prophetic of what was going to happen later. And, you know, his way of depicting God in Moses and Aaron, for example, with the choruses singing simultaneously at different sort of pitches and rhythms, is inspired. Beyond belief, because it gives that ethereal effect that no other composer in choral music has managed to get. There's a new St. Matthew Passion that's come out from a Russian composer whose name escaped me, quite a young composer. I played it on Essential Classics, the opening chorus. That was exceedingly beautiful, and I may bring that up. I'm hearing stuff all the time. And the great thing, I mean, the rucksack, which I refer to sometimes, is actually over there somewhere, which does exist. Every time, on Essential Classics, I leave space at the end of the programme where I go in, a bit of a bully boy like this, I say, look, I've just got this, it's fantastic, please trust me, and let's play it. There was one by Goretzky's son, Mikolaj Goretzky, a beautiful piece. We got loads of people writing in response to that. So I know that 20th century music and 21st century music is a very, very important issue. And I know I'm rooting for these early recordings, but I'm also rooting for 20 for modern music as well. So that's a very important point. Thank you.
Is there any possibility of this presentation being developed on BBC 3 or BBC 4? Is there any possibility of this presentation, which was absolutely wonderful, being developed on the BBC, on the radio, or on BBC 4, maybe as a series?
I think they got well enough of me, actually, before asking. That is very sweet and very appreciative of you, and I appreciate you saying it. I don't know. I mean, the thing about going to Radio 3 with ideas is that the presenters, I mean, when Roger Wright took me on nearly 15 years ago, it was the specific programme that had been built for me. And it was a great programme called CD Masters, and I did play all this stuff then. Then it all changed, and the culture changed, and everything like that. I'd love to think that I could develop it. I mean, I'm a great lover of poetry. That's another great love of mine. And I'd love to do poetry and music. I mean, there's Words and Music, which I think is one of the best things on Radio 3. Absolutely fantastic. Without the intervention of a presenter. But I, with the dear late Humphrey Burton, I did, the first thing I did was on Japanese haiku, and I brought them in the afternoon, it was called In Tune then, and I said, let me bring some little haiku, and little bits of Ligeti, or bits of Bartok, Microcosmos, or for children, and I'll read the haiku, and I'll find a piece of Bartok that reflects the mood of the haiku. And Humphrey got really excited by this, and I think we're onto something. And I wrote to Roger Wright and said, do you think we can do this on a regular basis? Just about 2 or 3 minutes at different points in the day. No, I've got another idea for you. And that was Essential Classics, CV Masters. But in answer to your question, I'd love to think so. But I'd love to do it. But how, you know, they've got so many other things they want to do. I mean, I will quote you. That's the best I can say. And they'll tap me on the head, you know. They're very, very nice, you know, very good. And send me on my way. But anyway, thank you. I very much appreciate that.
Yes. Well, thank you very much for the fascinating lecture.
Well, it's lovely.
I mean, if there were time, I've got about 100 questions I'd love to ask you. But we'll just stick to one. I'd heard the story about the Mozart 23rd performance, where Stalin had assumed it was a record when in fact it was a live broadcast.
Yeah.
So when he said, I want a copy of the record, they had to record it. I've never actually heard, I've heard the story, but I've never heard the recording before. And that was an astonishing performance.
Yes.
Let's say Keystone concert.
Yes,
despite the fantastic pace.
I know.
Everything came across so clearly.
Have you heard any of Udina's other recordings? I don't know what there is on YouTube. I mean, she did a remarkable Diabelli variations, the Goldberg variations. She did some Brahms.
Yeah, Brahms intermezzos.
Brahms intermezzos and things like that. And I think she did the Choral Fantasia with Beethoven. She's done there's quite a lot with her. And I think she did the Tchaikovsky sonata. Oh, definitely the Stravinsky sonata.
So as far as that Mozart recording that they had to do at the great man's request, the great monster's request, do you have any feelings yourself as to why it was so fast? I mean, it feels absolutely right. It must be the fastest performance of that last movie.
Well,
but it feels like it might have been just to fit it on one side of the 78. Yeah. It might have been because of the urgency of the situation. But it doesn't feel forced.
No, it doesn't. I agree with you. I think it may just be the way she played it. You know, I mean, she was a very eccentric interpreter. And it doesn't sound to me, like you, it doesn't sound wrong. Like sometimes, like that Furtwängler, Beethoven 9. Now that super fast prestissimo at the end, which is ridiculously fast, is the way he always conducted it, even in 1954, the year of just a month or so before he died. So, you know, that was probably her way with the 23rd concerto. Thank you.
I'm so glad we're going to get the CD.
Well, I think you can probably download it. I'm not sure. Yeah, anyway.
Thanks. There's just a quick question, then a follow-up question, which will be more interesting, hopefully. The first one is, on the recording, the Mahler recording, where someone shouted out in the audience, could you just repeat what they actually said? Quickly.
Did Deutschland über alles Herr Schuricht? Schuricht, Schuricht, was the conductor. And what the point he was making, you know, you don't conduct the music of a Jew, you're a German. That was the point he was making.
Yeah.
Or she was making. I presume it was she. No, she was making. Yeah.
And this, the follow up question is obviously. That's a very horrible thing to shout out. But in terms of normal, regular classical performances, any kind of intervention from the audience or thing that isn't in the complete hushed environment is very frowned upon. And do you think, I'm not saying I agree with this view, but do you think maybe the formularity and the very strict regulation often associated with classical performance may deter younger listeners? And people maybe of my age from involving in classical music?
100%. The Halle Orchestra are about to embark on a experiment where you pay when you go out of the concert rather than when you go in, and you can react. I mean, I can't imagine being at a performance of Beethoven's Fourth Symphony and shouting out, Allegro ma non troppo here, rattle. Which could be a good bit of advice. But you know, I was going to go on television talking about this, and unfortunately they couldn't get me up, and they contacted me. But I think this is an absolutely fascinating subject, and I think depends on the music. If it's a Mozart symphony, I don't think most people will want the interruption because it's a beautifully formed structure. You don't want, but if it's something like the Rite of Spring by Stravinsky, or Bartok's Miraculous Mandarin, or Ionization by Varese, or Amerique by Varese, or Different Trains by Steve Reich, or something like that. Yeah, why not get up? Why not rock in your chair? You know, I was at a concert at the Festival Hall, and I'm very physical, as you probably notice when I'm listening to music. I do apologize for that. And I was listening to something, and I was going backwards and forwards about it. It came to the interval, and it's Tony tapped me on the back of my head and said, "Will you keep still?" Absolutely incensed. And I thought, well, I was really enjoying myself. Why can't you enjoy yourself, your miserable partner? And I think it does put people off, you know, that formal way of presenting things, the way you've got to sit there. Whereas you go to a rock concert or you go to a jazz concert, and let's face it, in the days of Telemann and Mozart, it was informal. People used to eat, new music was performed while they were eating, while they were dancing, while they were doing all sorts of things. So I think that we want, I hope this Halle experiment works. And I'd like to go into the Royal Festival Hall and feel during a performance of the Writer's Spring that people could be jumping up and down just as the dancers were in the premiere that caused a riot. Hopefully it wouldn't cause a riot in the Royal Festival Hall. But I think it's a very, very good point and well worth raising. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, yes, please.
Thank you. Unlike the man who tapped you on the head and told you to be quiet, one of my favourite things about tonight has been watching you listen to the music. So, one, I wondered, do you play any instruments or sing? And two, I wondered what on earth got you into music at such a young age? What inspired you?
Well, I did do evening classes, thank you. I did do evening classes in violin and in cello. I wasn't much good at either, but I actually haven't got those instruments anymore, but I did sort of mess around with them for quite a few years. What got me into music when I was very young? When I was very, very young, I was into the Everly Brothers, Lonnie Donegan, Elvis Presley, and Buddy Holly. And then what happened? I got ill. I got rheumatic fever when I was 12 years old. I woke up one day and couldn't feel my legs. And I was rushed into hospital. They thought I had osteomyelitis. And that was the beginning of a period of 6 months where I had bed rest. And after I came out of hospital, I was in hospital for a number of weeks. I went to my bedroom and I had a record player. That was the radio and the record player were my great sources of comfort, apart from my mother and my father. And my step-grandfather brought a 2-LP set back from America called 50 Years of Music, America Loves Best. And it had people like Benny Goodman, you know, we heard tonight, Count Basie, I don't know, Paul White, and all the jazz giants, and a few people like Perry Como. So I thought, oh good, I'll just play those tracks. So I listened to those tracks. Suddenly, I heard the prelude to Act 3 of Wagner's Lohengrin with Toscanini. And that was it. I thought, oh my God, this is fantastic. And I loved it, and eventually I went back to school, and I saved up my pocket money, and then my step-grandfather said, well, what would you like for your birthday or for Christmas or something? I said, well, I'd love an all Wagner LP. And he got the recording. Well, Toscanini conducting this thing was like a jet, and I was mad on aircraft. I wanted to be a pilot in those days. And it was like a jet aircraft, you know, roaring up the runway and flying into the air. Well, the version he got was Otto Klemperer and the Philharmonia. And that was like a sort of tiger moth, which hadn't quite managed to get off the ground. It was so slow by comparison. And that was another case of realizing what comparative interpretation was about. So that was it. Because basically, it was an inspiration. I was in a forced situation, and I previously loved film music from films I'd seen. And then, you know, I got some Bach organ music with Albert Schweitzer, which I loved, and got another LP of Wagner, and started going to markets and things, picking up 70s. It all started from there. And I used to play it, making my own radio shows, you know. Probably better than the ones I do now. But anyway, that's how it started. That's how it started. One more? Anybody want one more? One more.
Yes, it was your mentioning of being a great fan of film music.
Yes.
I've always had a sort of unproven idea, and I wondered if there's something you knew about it, that early film composers might have been pupils of Bruckner.
Well, funnily enough, that's a very interesting point, because the Carousel Waltz, I made this point, I gave a talk to a film society, And I don't know, I'm going to try and hum this bit of the Carousel Waltz. There's a bit that goes, ya-da-dee-dum, la-dum-dee-dum, dee-dum. So it's la-da-dee, la-da-da-da-da, 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 la-da-da-da-da. Notice how the strings are. It's just like Bruckner's Seventh Symphony. And I'm absolutely sure that all these composers, that this is the great thing about classic film scores, Max Steiner, Franz Waxman, Alfred Newman, all these people, is that what you're getting, in a way, is sort of condensed versions of the classics. Schumann, Tchaikovsky, Bruckner, Beethoven, not quite Mahler, because Mahler was too modern. But all these people turn up in great film scores. And I think that that was probably one of the great influences on me. That's why I heard Bruckner, and I didn't hear his film music. I don't know what the film was, but you know, I definitely did. I heard it a bit like that, so I think that's a very valid point.
Okay, well, thank you, Mr. Notchell. Before I invite you to show your due appreciation, I thanked Hannah earlier on. Actually, there's someone else I think I should thank publicly, because he always gets forgotten about, and that's Bruce, whose tech support for this series has been fantastic. We're a college, and things don't usually work. Just pick up on a couple of things Rob said, the first of which was about the fact that he did violin and then cello in an evening class. Now, if any of you fancy following his example and having a go at violin or cello in an evening class, you'll be fascinated to know that Morley offers just that. So please, as you go out, take one of our prospectuses and look through it, and there may be other goodies in there which you are interested in. So if you don't know about Morley and what he does, take our prospectus or look us up on the website and find out how you might want to come back next term and see us. The second thing I'd just like to pick up is the model of funding which happens at the Halle. You'll remember at the beginning I said it was a penny to get in, but somewhat more to get out. So, as I said, if you've enjoyed tonight, have a look at the book, and if you'd like to buy a copy, please do so, make a donation to our bursary fund. So with that, thank you so much, Rob. It's been a fantastic evening.
It's been
and
a fantastic
perfect way to end our series.
Fantastic.